Welcome back, everybody. Today we're going to start a new chapter in our course. We're going to learn a third type of t-test. So far we've learned the one sample t-test, the independent samples t-test, and today we're going to start talking about the related samples t-test. Like the other t-tests that we learned, we can use the four-step hypothesis testing procedure to test our data. What I want to do in this video is discuss when the related samples t-test is the most appropriate test to do, and also we'll talk about the basic logic of the test. In order to know when to use the related samples t-test, let's quickly review the differences between a between subjects research design and a within subjects research design. Remember, when we're talking about research designs, we're just talking about how a researcher sets up the study. In other words, how do they collect the data? That's really important because the statistical analyses that we do are dictated by the research design. The statistical analyses that we decide to do are dictated based on how the data was collected. And in most studies, we collect data from two or more samples of people or things. For example, we've talked quite a bit already about between subjects research designs, also known as independent samples research designs. In an independent samples research design, we collect data from two or more completely independent groups of people. So for example, we might collect data from men and from women and compare them. Or we might compare data from older people and younger people and compare them. In those situations, the two groups are completely separate. They're independent. So if you think about it, we're comparing two different sets of data. A set of data for the men, and then a set of data for the women. A set of data for the older people compared to a set of data for the younger people. However, there's another way that we can end up with two sets of data, and that's when we're using a within subjects, also known as a related samples, research design. Of those two labels, I prefer related samples research design, because in any example that we discuss, it's clear to see that the two data sets we're comparing are related, and that's because they typically come from the exact same people. What I mean by that is that we measure the exact same people more than once. For example, I might measure my statistics students on the very first day of class to see how much they know in general about statistics. And then at the end of the semester, I might give them that exact same test to see how much they've learned over the past several weeks. In that example, I end up with two sets of data. Data from the students at time one, and then data from those exact same students at time two. The most appropriate way to analyze that data is with a related samples t-test, and what we do is we analyze how much did those students change from time one to time two. In other words, how much do they differ from time one to time two? All of our analyses for a related samples t-test will be based on those different scores, and we'll talk about those in just a minute. While we're talking about basic research design issues, it makes sense to bring up the matched subjects research design. There are some times where it doesn't make sense to measure the exact same people more than once, and in those situations, researchers often try to simulate a related samples research design by comparing two different groups of people who have been matched. They're often matched on a variety of different attributes, on a variety of different factors, in an effort to make those groups as similar as possible. So, for example, the groups might be matched based on their sex, based on their age, based on their race, based on their educational level, maybe based on physiological factors like their body mass index, maybe based on economic factors like their family income. And you can probably notice a problem here. At what point do we stop? We can match people on thousands, hundreds of thousands of different factors, and it's easy to identify what we consider the important factors. But there might be factors that distinguish between people, that differ between people, that we don't recognize, and we might fail to match people on those variables. So matching is something that tries to simulate a related samples research design where we measure the exact same people more than once, but ultimately, we are typically unable to match one person perfectly with another person, and that's why a true related samples research design would be preferable. Regardless if we use a related samples research design or a matched samples research design, we would analyze the data the same way, and that's with different scores. Let's talk about that next. As you might assume, computing difference scores is easy. I just want to make sure that we all do it the same way, and you'll see what I mean by that in just a second. Let's switch views and do this together. When we compute difference scores, we will be computing D values. D just stands for difference. And we're always going to want to compute these difference scores the same way. This is how we're going to do it. We're going to take the score from time 2, subtract the score from time 1, and that will give us our difference score. Let's go through an example and I'll show you what I mean. Let's say that I've created a magic pill, and I'm hoping that it'll make you smarter. So I want to test it. So I measure you at time 1. I administer a basic IQ test, just to see what your baseline intelligence score is. Then I measure you again after about a month or so of taking this magic pill, to see what your IQ score is at that time. So I've got measurements at time 1 and time 2. Here's the measurement at time 1, here's the measurement at time 2. According to our formula right here, we can compute difference scores by taking your IQ score at time 2 and then subtracting your IQ score from time 1. In this case, 85 minus 110 is negative 25. So far it's not looking too good for my magic pill. Let's take a look at that second example. Again, you can see that your IQ actually went down from time 1 to time 2. If we use this formula the way it's set, take the value at time 2, 80, subtract the value at time 1, 95, we get a value of negative 15. Do you see how using that formula, we get a negative number when values decrease from time 1 to time 2, and we should get a positive number when values increase from time 1 to time 2. Let's look at that third example. Again, the IQ scores went down from time 1 to time 2, so we're expecting to find a negative difference score. Using our formula, we'll take 105, which is the value from time 2, and subtract 120, which is the value from time 1. And that's a difference of negative 15 points on that IQ test. Now let's look at that last example. We can see that the IQ score went up from time 1 to time 2. So let's take 106, the IQ score at time 2, subtract 105, the IQ score at time 1, and we'll see that there's an increase of 1 point. So I'm not saying this is rocket science. I'm not saying this is difficult. I'm just saying I want to make sure we all do this the same way. And by doing it this way, that difference score will tell us if scores have increased or decreased. Now, for this small set of data, we can compute an average of all of the different scores. When we're dealing with typical values, typical X scores, the sample mean is symbolized with an X bar. But when we're dealing with different scores, D values, the mean difference score is symbolized with a D bar. So we can compute a mean difference score using this formula. All that we need to do is add up all of the different scores and then divide by the number of different scores. Let's find the sum of all of the different scores. Make sure you know how to use negative numbers on your calculator. So at this point, I'm going to put in 25 and I'm going to make it negative. To that, I'm going to add negative 15. And then I'm going to add another negative 15. And then finally, I'm going to add 1. So the sum of all of those different scores equals negative 54. To compute the mean difference score, we now need to divide that by the number of different scores. There are 4 different scores, so let's divide by 4. That equals negative 13.5. So D bar for this first set of data was equal to negative 13.5. You can see the negative nature of that value shows that on average, IQ scores decreased from time 1 to time 2. Let's go through this second set of data real quickly. You'll see in this case, the IQ scores tend to increase over time instead of decrease over time. So we should find more positive difference scores compared to negative difference scores. Using the formula for difference scores that we used before, we're going to take the data from time 2 and then subtract the data from time 1. When you look at the data for this first person, it looks like my magic pill is working pretty well. I take their IQ score from time 2, which is 110, and then I subtract their IQ score from time 1, which was 85. That's a difference, an increase of 25 points in their IQ. This next person has an increase in their IQ as well. They end up with an IQ of 95, but started off with an IQ of 80. 95 minus 80 equals positive 15. Let's look at the next person. They ended up with an IQ of 120, started off with an IQ of 105. 120 minus 105, again, is a positive 15, showing an increase in their IQ. That last person, though, showed a decrease in their IQ from time 1 to time 2. They ended up with a final IQ value of 105, but began with an IQ value of 106. If we take 105 and subtract 106, we get negative 1, showing a decrease of 1 point in their IQ. Just like we did above, we can compute a mean difference score based on all of those individual difference scores. We'll take 25, add 15, add another 15, and then finally add negative 1. That sums up to 54. If we take 54 and we divide by the number of difference scores that we have, and we have 4 different scores, 54 divided by 4 equals positive 13.5. So on average, based on the data set we just looked at, the IQ scores are increasing from time 1 to time 2 by 13.5 IQ points. So for this data set, the mean difference score is equal to positive 13.5. That's how we're going to compute difference scores, my friends, and that's how we will find mean difference scores. Now just give this some thought for a second. What do you think the mean difference score will be based on the null hypothesis? Remember, null hypotheses always state no differences, no change. In this case, the most appropriate way to view it is no change from time 1 to time 2. If indeed there is no change from time 1 to time 2, the population mean difference score should be 0. What that means is that we will have to look at the sample mean difference score that we have obtained and then look and see where it falls in a distribution of all possible sample mean difference scores. That's what this sampling distribution will represent in this situation. It's not a distribution of sample means like we had for the one sample t-test. It's not a distribution of differences between sample means like we had for the independent samples t-test. This is a distribution of sample mean difference scores. And keep in mind, just like always, we create that sampling distribution based on the idea that the null hypothesis is true. If the null hypothesis is true in this situation, there are no changes from time 1 to time 2. So right there in the middle of this distribution of sample mean difference scores, we should find a population mean difference score that's mu sub d, a population mean difference score that is equal to 0. So on this x-axis right here, we're plotting sample mean difference scores. And this logic should seem pretty familiar. Remember, we have sampling error. Even if there are no differences between time 1 to time 2, we're probably going to find a sample mean difference score that doesn't exactly equal 0. Just by chance, just due to sampling error, we should see sample mean difference scores that vary from 0. When the null hypothesis is true, most of those sample mean difference scores should be relatively close to 0. But remember, when the null hypothesis is true, we will sometimes find sample means that are quite extreme, but those will be very uncommon. And at some point, we just need to draw the line. At some point, we need to say we have enough evidence that our data is inconsistent with the null hypothesis. As I mentioned, this should sound familiar. This is the exact same logic we've been using all along, ever since we learned the four-step hypothesis testing procedure. So, in other words, at some point we will draw a line, and we will create that rejection zone. And if we find a sample mean difference score that's in that rejection zone, we'll say that that data is so inconsistent with the null hypothesis that we no longer believe the null hypothesis is true, and we will reject it. At that point, we will have enough evidence to say there are statistically significant differences from time 1 to time 2. In order to figure out where our sample mean difference score falls in this distribution, we need to transform that sample mean difference score into a t-value, and we'll use this formula right here. Here's the good news, my friends. That t formula right there is almost identical to the same formula that we used when we did a one-sample t-test. Instead of x bar right here, a sample mean, we have d bar, a sample mean difference score. Instead of mu right here, which is always based on the null hypothesis, we have mu d, which again is always based on the null hypothesis. instead of simply representing the population mean, it represents, more specifically, the population mean difference score. And here's another nice thing about this related samples t-test. That value, mu sub d, is always equal to zero, always. And that's because that value is always based on the null hypothesis being true, and the null hypothesis states that the population mean difference score is zero. In other words, there are no differences from time one to time two. So just like always, the numerator of this test statistic measures differences that we're actually observing. And then we need to divide by some measurement of differences we would expect just by chance. And that's what the standard error is all about. Previously, when we were working on the one sample t-test, this represented the standard error of the mean. Well, now it essentially represents the same thing, but more specifically, it represents the standard error of the mean difference score. Just like always, it's a measurement of sampling error. So in this case, it's going to show us how much those mean difference scores will differ from zero just by chance. Its formal name is the estimated standard error of the mean difference score. But remember, we abbreviate things. We just refer to it as standard error. In this case, the equation for standard error is right here. That formula should look familiar. When we computed the standard error of the mean for the one sample t-test, we took the standard deviation and we divided by the square root of the sample size. In this situation, we're doing essentially the exact same thing. Remember, all of our analyses are based now on difference scores. So in the numerator, we'll simply compute the standard deviation of the difference scores. That's what S sub D stands for. S is always our symbol for standard deviation. The little sub D just represents the standard deviation for the difference scores. And then we will divide by the square root of our sample size, in other words, the square root of the number of difference scores. So have you heard me say difference scores enough in this video? It's really important to remember that all of the calculations that we do, all of the analyses that we do, are based on difference scores. Well, I think that's enough for now. I just wanted to make sure that you understand the basic logic of this related samples t-test. In the next video, I'll show you how to compute degrees of freedom so that we can find the critical regions for our four-step hypothesis testing procedure. And then we'll have all the information that we need to do our first related samples t-test. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.